Hello everyone, welcome to today's tutorial in which I'll talk about a very basic electronic device, an oscillator. As the name suggests, oscillator is a device which generates oscillations of a particular frequency, and of course the oscillations have to be sustained oscillations so that they are usable in different applications. And the oscillator is used in laptops to generate the clock signal and is also used to generate carrier frequency in various applications of radio, mobile receivers, etc. So oscillator is a device which takes DC as input or works on DC signal, and it gives out alternating signal or the AC output, and the order of the frequency of the generated oscillations may vary from a few hertz to maybe some hundreds of the gigahertz. And apart from generating a sinusoidal signal, it is also capable of generating a non-sinusoidal signal or non-sinusoidal oscillations. So that classifies an oscillator into a different type, which I'll discuss towards the end of this tutorial. So by definition, an oscillator is nothing but an amplifier which is given a positive feedback. Now let us see, with the help of the configuration, how an amplifier is made to work like an oscillator and how it is given a positive feedback. So let us say I have an amplifier here and its gain is A, the output voltage is V0, and I take a summing point here to which I am giving the input voltage Vin, which is also going as input to this amplifier, and a part of this output is fed back to the input via a feedback circuit having gain beta, and this is provided to the input. Now what will happen? Let us say I give a sinusoidal input as V in to this amplifier and I get the output V naught. You can very easily make out that V naught will be equal to the gain multiplied by the input signal V in. So V naught is equal to gain times the input voltage V in. And this beta here is a frequency selective circuit. Please remember this, that this is a frequency selective circuit, which is a very important aspect of this oscillator. This being a frequency selective circuit, we will see in a few minutes that this will provide a zero phase shift to a particular frequency, and it will provide different values of the phase shifts to the other components of the signals. Now at this point, let us say we have a voltage signal which is being fed back to the input, and I name it as Vf. So this Vf is equal to beta times the input which is going to the feedback circuit. So Vf becomes equal to beta times V naught, and substituting the value for V naught, I get Vf is equal to A beta times the input voltage V in. So beta here defines what fraction of output voltage is given as feedback to the input of the amplifier. So here A beta, which is again a very important part of the oscillator, is known as the loop gain. Why loop gain? Because here I have the forward path gain A and the feedback gain beta. So this product is known as the loop gain. Now we have a very clear relationship between the feedback voltage Vf and the input voltage Vin. Now A beta is going to play a very vital role in the generation of the oscillations. Let us see how. Now if A beta, this the value of loop gain, is less than 1. Now I'll assume that, let in a specific case I have the input voltage Vin equal to 2 volts and the loop gain A beta, which in this case I assume it to be less than unity, let us say it is equal to 0.9. Now what will happen to the feedback voltage Vf, which is being fed back to the input of the amplifier? This Vf, as per the formula, will be equal to 0.9 into 2 volts, which is equal to 1.8 volt. Now every time the input passes through the loop, V naught is reduced by a factor, as here we started with 2 volt and now Vf is 1.8 volt. So the earlier input voltage, which was 2 volt, now the input which is going as the voltage which is going as input to the amplifier has reduced and it has come down to 1.8 volt. Further, now this 1.8 volt will again gets multiplied by our loop gain and it further reduces. So in this case, the oscillations that we are going to see at the output of the oscillator are going to be like this. Starting with the amplitude, these oscillations are going to die out. So for a loop gain A beta having a value less than unity, the oscillations are going to die out over a period of time. Similarly, if I keep the value of loop gain A beta to be greater than 1, in that case the reverse is going to happen and at the output I'll have the oscillations which are building up over a period of time. So that means the value of loop gain is playing a very vital role in deciding the nature of the oscillations that we have at the output. So in any scenario or in any application, we would like to have sustained oscillations of a particular frequency, and in order to have sustained oscillations of any particular frequency, the loop gain A beta has to be equal to unity. Now whenever this loop gain A beta is kept equal to unity, at the output of the oscillator, I see sustained oscillations not dying out and not building up, remaining at a constant amplitude. So this is what we want to get from an oscillator which is considered to be working fine. So this is the very critical factor in the working of the oscillator, or a determining factor how the oscillator is going to behave and what kind of oscillations will it provide at the output. Now this factor has been consolidated by Barkhausen and is known as the Barkhausen criteria of oscillations. Now this Barkhausen criteria of oscillations lists down two conditions in order to get sustained oscillations. The first condition, as I've already discussed, is the loop gain should be equal to 1 or unity, and the another condition is that the phase difference should be 0 degrees. Now if the phase difference is 0 degrees between the input and the output, only then I'm going to get the sustained oscillations at the output. Now after having discussed the Barkhausen criteria of oscillations, I would like to discuss here, or like to tell you that whenever we use an oscillator practically, it does not have an input connected to it. Yes. So that simply means that an oscillator works on a zero input signal. Now how is that possible? If there is no input which is being supplied here, that means this Vin is zero, Still, the oscillator is providing sustained oscillations at the output. So this is a very interesting fact in the working of the oscillator, that in spite of providing zero input, it is still capable of providing the sustained oscillations if the Barkhausen criteria of oscillations is satisfied. Now this happens due to the presence of thermal noise. Now this thermal noise will be responsible for generating the sustained oscillations in spite of giving zero input to the oscillator. Now how does this happen? As I have already mentioned, that this beta in the feedback path is a frequency selective device. So what will happen, as we all know, that thermal noise is having a multiple frequency components present in it, ranging from a few hertz to higher values in hertz. And because beta being the frequency selective device, for only one frequency it will give a phase shift which will be zero, and for only that particular frequency the second condition of Barkhausen criteria of oscillations is going to be satisfied. And until and unless these both the criterias are satisfied at a time, we don't get the sustained oscillations. So this criteria of having phase shift equal to zero, that is, this beta is responsible for satisfying the second criteria of the Barkhausen oscillations. So that means we have to have this feedback to be a frequency selective, so that only for one particular frequency I'll have a zero phase shift. And apart from this, initially I'll keep the value of loop gain to be greater than unity. Why? Because out of multiple frequency components present in the thermal noise, for only one frequency component I'll have a zero phase shift, and I want that one frequency component to build over a period of time. I want the oscillations to be something like this, because initially the thermal noise will have a very low amplitude, and if I want to thermal noise to build up, I'll have to keep this A beta to be greater than unity. So initially we keep this loop gain to be greater than unity, due to which the noise signal builds up over a period of time, and once a respectable amplitude is achieved, we again keep A beta equal to 1, which is the first condition for getting the sustained oscillations. So that is how from a thermal noise we have been able to get sustained oscillations as per our frequency selection. And further, if we even want to prove the Barkhausen criteria of oscillations mathematically, that can also be done very easily. I'll tell you how. Now here in this case, if I cut off, now in order to prove this criteria mathematically, it's very easy. Let us assume that this VF and this VIN are being supplied as input to the amplifier. Now in this case, at the output I'll get V naught, which is equal to A times VIN plus VF, and also VF is equal to beta times V naught. Now substituting this value here, V naught becomes equal to A V in plus A beta V naught. On rearranging, I get right. Now I take the ratio of V naught upon V in, which equals to A upon 1 minus A beta. Now please understand and pay attention to this equation. Now here we say that there's no input voltage which is being applied to this configuration. If there is no input voltage, that clearly indicates that Vin is equal to 0. And if Vin is equal to 0, then this 1 minus A beta should also be equal to 0. And A beta should be equal to 1, which is the mathematical proof of the condition of the Barkhausen criteria. So that's quite simple. And coming to the classification of the oscillators, the oscillators can be classified depending upon the feedback circuit that we are using. This feedback circuit, the kind of feedback circuit that we are using, classifies an oscillator into three different types, namely RC oscillator, LC oscillator, and the crystal oscillator. Please remember that all these three types of oscillators are harmonic oscillators, or in other words, sinusoidal oscillators, and they are going to generate only sinusoidal oscillations. And in the category of non-sinusoidal oscillators, we have the relaxation oscillator. So the kind of oscillations that we are going to see at the output of a relaxation oscillator would either be a square wave or triangular or maybe sawtooth wave. So I'll try to cover these types of oscillators in detail in the future videos to come. So I hope this tutorial on oscillators, and most important, the Barkhausen criteria of oscillations, was of help, and it helped you in understanding the concepts and the criteria and various conditions which are required to be satisfied to get the sustained oscillations. So see you soon in the more videos to come. Have a good day. Bye.